When you looked at who was using synthetic cannabinoids in the National Drug Strategy Household Survey, virtually everybody who had used a synthetic had also used natural cannabis. And one of the and when people are using these, they're using these because they're seeking a cannabis-like experience. There's also novelty in trying something slightly different. But consistently in every survey that you see of consumers, synthetic cannabinoids rate poorly in comparison to the effects of natural cannabis. So this is data from the Global Drug Survey, which is one of the, you know, it's the most powerful way you've got at getting at these low prevalence events. GDS has got somewhere between 20 and 40,000 people internationally completing the survey. And so if you get people to compare their experience of natural cannabis and synthetic cannabinoids, people regard it as significantly less pleasurable, less value for money, they feel more bombed out after use, and they feel more negative effects when they're high. In the US in particular, there's been comparative studies that people have less positive outcome expectancies and more negative outcome expectancies. So it's not a drug that people are naturally seeking out. There's better options. I guess people find that there are better options if they are available. So let's talk a little bit about harms. And one of the reasons that we end up with harms is that we have an ever more potent product that's not necessarily made to good manufacturing practice standards. This was a lab seized in Queensland. It's not quite as sophisticated as the ones Rebecca was talking about. Basically, it was a bunch of blokes in Queensland who had got synthetic cannabinoids. They got some plant matter, shoved them in the cement mixer, sprayed it in while it was going. Bob's your uncle, they dried it out on the back of a ute, which I think it's hard to get any more Australian than drying out your product on the back of a ute. But the problem is, when you've got high potent substances and they're not mixed very well, you run very significant risk of hot spots of a very large dose. So that can make things that have the same product in them, packet to packet, or you know, grabbed from the same bag, can be quite variable in potency, and that adds risk. Also, the people that are buying the synthetic cannabinoids and importing it in don't necessarily know the right way to titrate their comparative doses. And so we run the risk of sudden outbreak events like we've seen for fentanyl, and I'll talk a little bit about these. And these are things that we need to be constantly vigilant about. The Global Drug Survey also did some really good work looking at, okay, if you're a consumer of this substance, have you gone to seek emergency medicine support in the last year? And it gives you some realistic comparisons about how risky particular substances are. Out of the last year consumers of synthetic cannabinoids, you were much more likely to go and see emergency support than you were most other drugs. It was in the top three. If you look at the ratio though, the number of people that sought treatment in comparison to the days that they'd used it, you were less likely than 1 in 1,000 to need emergency responses. That's still 30 times more likely than natural cannabis, so it's significantly more risky. But this gives us a bit of a sense of trying to get a more realistic view about how risky these substances are. Now, in terms of what sort of things you might see in an acute context, I went through the very systematic studies that have been done across emergency rooms across the US, and they are systematic, and so they look quite informative, but because the nature of the product changes very rapidly over time, information that you've got from a paper looking at presentations in 2010 isn't necessarily going to be informative about what you're seeing now. This is data, this is from the NEPTUNE, the Novel Psychoactive Treatment UK Network, which has a great guide for how to respond to all of the boutique drugs, and I've got a link to that at the end of the presentation. But that's a great clinical guide for practical suggestions about what you should do. In particular, some of the more common things you see across cannabinoids are chest pain, problems with breathing, very much a tachycardia, regular pulse, hypertension, and vomiting seem to be very common reasons for seeking assistance. In terms of acute clinical responses, again, this is from the NEPTUNE data. There isn't a reversal agent that we've got. The data from emergency wards tends to suggest that about half of the people that present will respond to some sort of quiet hydration and being left quietly and will resolve within sort of 1 to 20 hours. And the focus is on managing the symptoms. There's been some case studies of people using benzodiazepines successfully for agitation, and also some strong antipsychotics like haloperidol for people that have existing psychosis. We did have a cannabinoid receptor antagonist available on the market, rimonabant. It was used as a weight loss drug, but it had a lot of psychiatric side effects. But that has been shown in at least animal literature to be a good reversal agent for a number of these things. Okay, I mentioned that there have been, while the adverse events are relatively low prevalence, there have been a number of high impact outbreaks, which is a function of the fact that people are making substances which are entirely novel and have no animal data behind them whatsoever and no thought other than what can we do to make it bind more strongly at CB1. There's been something that has been happening recently, a case series of people that have had acute respiratory failure requiring intubation. They had no pre-existing pulmonary disease. We've had the zombie outbreak in New York City, which was basically people being so intoxicated that they had almost a shut-in syndrome in that they were largely non-responsive. One of the more recent things, there's been a contamination of a bunch of synthetic cannabinoids with an anticoagulant, and so people ended up with quite significant long-lasting bleeding complications. So it's something that you need to keep an eye on because these things can pop up very quickly. I'm just going to... There are some deaths associated with this. The New Zealand State of the Nation report suggests that there's been 50 deaths in the last year in New Zealand. That would be more than we've seen in a lot of other larger jurisdictions. So I'm not 100% sure about what's going on there, and there's a range of reasons behind the deaths. I will leave you with some links to some sensible, the clinical guidelines, the NEPTUNE network is something that I think all clinicians on the front line should be aware of. It's really great, up-to-date, sensible advice. If you want to know about the bleeding edge of novel psychoactives, there's the American group that do a lot of the forensic testing, have that site available, and for harm reduction information, there's a bunch of good information out of New Zealand. Thank you.
Thanks, Ray. First question, can the synthetic cannabinoids be tested in routine urine drug testing?
There's the potential for cross-reactivity, but in general, the point of the market is to stay ahead of the things that are available on simple commercial screens. If you send to larger labs like a lot of the larger labs can pick these things up, but not in your garden variety UDSs.
This is a hard one to work out. While illegal to import, youth seen in emergency department. While illegal to import, comma, youth seen in emergency departments often order huge amounts of very many different drugs online, including cannabinoids and fentanyl, etc.
I think this is actually, it helps you put these drugs in context, because where people are bringing stuff in independently that they've got from the dark web, you get a real sense of how popular synthetics actually are, because in the dark web you are free to access and buy any drug that you want. But the things that mainly sell through the dark web are the traditional things: cocaine, MDMA in high potency, and cannabis and counterfeit pharmaceuticals. The actual number of sales for the synthetics on the dark web are ridiculously low by comparison.